a beautiful space. What a wonderful space to speak in. Okay, I'm going to be talking about schizophrenia today. And I want to start by just talking about how significant schizophrenia is as a disorder. It is a major public health problem of grand scope. The prevalence rate in the world, across the world, is a half to an entire percent. That's a lot of people who suffer from the disorder. 80% of the people with the disorder are unable to work. 0.5% of people who end up getting on disability ever come off disability. So it's a chronic, lifelong problem, extremely significant lifelong problem. There are estimates that 50% of our homeless suffer from schizophrenia. In fact, if you were to go to Main Street right now, you would find a large array of people suffering from the disease. It is an extremely common disease and very, very common among our homeless. It is also very common amongst the prison population. So there are estimates now that 25 to 30% of people who are incarcerated would meet criteria for schizophrenia. This is a major, major public health issue. Okay, let me start by talking a little bit about what defines the disorder. By DSM-IV criteria, which was formulated in 1994, they basically stated that there were 2 of 5 symptoms that had to be expressed over a month period to merit the diagnosis. The first symptom are delusions, and delusions are irrational beliefs. Now, it can often be hard to understand exactly what's an irrational belief. We all know people who have irrational beliefs, so that qualifies being schizophrenia. It's a bit more than that. So the irrational beliefs tend to take the form of things like paranoid delusions, the idea that you might be followed by the CIA, people might be after you in some way. And even when you challenge folks with evidence against those contentions, they tend to persist in their beliefs. They may have grandiose delusions. These grandiose delusions are delusions that they may be the son of God, that they may be actually planning to create miracles. I've actually worked with clients who told me that in 2013, they are actually going to part the Red Sea. They told me this and they're planning to do it. So these beliefs are real. Another common form of delusion are the idea of thought broadcasting. So this is the idea that when one has thoughts, these thoughts can be broadcasted out into the world. So the idea that whatever I'm thinking at the moment, you would all be able to hear that. And I've actually worked with clients as well who have actually refused to go into restaurants. They've been so concerned that when they got into the restaurant, their thoughts would be projected to everyone, and the other diners would have to leave the restaurant because it would be so disturbing for them to hear what they were thinking. So these are very, very serious symptoms, not mild cases of irrationality. A second symptom that's very common, probably what you hear from in the popular press most commonly, are hallucinations. They tend to be auditory, though, not visual, as is often portrayed. Disorganized speech is another major category of symptom. Grossly disorganized or catatonic behavior. Negative symptoms, so blunted affect, a reduction in social, interaction as well, is characterized as one of the symptoms. If you get 2 of these 5 symptoms over a month period, you will qualify for the diagnosis along with severe impairment in social and occupational functioning. So that's the diagnosis of schizophrenia. Now I can describe it, but I think it's easier to understand it from an actual case. So I'm going to read for you a case from the old Shenley Hospital in London. It was reported in the late 1970s, and the case is described as follows. This is from Eve Johnston from the Institute of Psychiatry, and describes a man who was admitted to hospital at the age of 22. He had left school at the age of 14 and worked as a tea boy and then as a builder's laborer. His mother died in a mental hospital when he was 6 years old. He received long-term treatment with antipsychotic drugs, but nonetheless, despite the drugs, he heard people talking about him and heard his thoughts spoken aloud. He believed that he was being persecuted and that people were trying to control his actions. And this idea of your actions being controlled by an entity outside of yourself is very, very common, is actually described in the very first accounts of the disorder. When examined in 1975, he continued to report many of these positive features. He complained that there was a coil oscillating which made noises that disturbed his mind. And he considered that he was being affected by bizarre physical forces that were controlling his body. So this is someone who has a long-term chronic course of the illness. gives you a feel for how persistent these symptoms are, how devastating they are, why so many of these people can't work, have problems functioning. Okay, so what I want to talk about now is I want to now relate this idea of schizophrenia to the nature-nurture distinction. And really, over the past, I would say, 20 to 30 years, the biological model has taken hold, right? The idea of the broken brain, the idea that a drug or a gene is going to solve this very complex disorder. And I want to raise today some critiques of that model, some holes in the model that I think raise some pretty significant questions for that approach to the illness. The extreme nature view of schizophrenia contends that schizophrenia, as described in this vignette, is basically caused by aberrant genes which are releasing aberrant proteins which are in turn creating disrupted neural systems. So you have neural systems that aren't functioning correctly. And these neural systems, in turn, are disrupting behavior. They're disrupting, causing the phenomenology that I just described to you. According to this model, the pathophysiology tends to be pretty consistent from case to case. We can think of it almost as diabetes, in a sense. Consistent with this view, in the 1980s, it was actually determined that bipolar illness, an illness very close to schizophrenia, they had determined where the chromosome was. It was chromosome 11. Everyone who had this disorder had a problem in chromosome 11. This finding was quickly disputed and thrown out. It didn't last for very long. Similar findings in schizophrenia were evident from chromosome 5, chromosome 6, also discredited. To be fair to the kind of extreme nature view, the evidence for this comes a lot, much of it comes from twin studies, where they look at folks who have identical genetic material, and they compare monozygotic twins, where the material is 100% identical, versus dizygotic twins, where it's on the order of about 50% in concordance. And they find that people who have identical genetic material are much more likely to have both of the pair develop the illness relative to pairs where only about half of the genetic material is shared. And this has been a big argument for the biological model. I would say that even in monozygotic twins, where you have identical genetic material, only 30% of the time you get a concordance. So you've got this huge 70% that you've got to wonder about what's going on there. Okay. I want to now point out two major studies that question this type of biological, strong nature approach to understanding schizophrenia. One of the findings is epidemiological work that was done during the hunger winter in Holland. This occurred in the winter of 1944-45. The Nazis had blockaded the western part of Holland, where the largest population is, and people were without food for long periods of time. In fact, Audrey Hepburn was living at that time in Holland and suffered a great deprivation, and she actually suffered from depression for the rest of her life, and there was some thought that that early deprivation may have had some effect on her subsequent development of depression. In this Dutch family, it's been women who were pregnant have been studied, and women who were starved for periods during this time gave birth to children who developed schizophrenia at a rate that was far beyond what would be predicted from basic genetic models. In fact, other areas of Holland, where there was not this blockade of fuel and food, showed the typical distribution of 0.5% to 1%. So this is, in short, giving you a sense of one of the major problems with this type of model. So I want to finish, I've got 30 seconds it looks like, so I want to finish at this point, this is a very short talk. I want to just leave you with the idea that schizophrenia is clearly a disorder that reflects a synergy of nature and nurture. Brain social forces that cannot be easily packaged as a genetically determined disruption of brain function. What should be clear is that a disease entity, which has been defined so radically differently at different points in history, and which even under current categorization schemes, you can have two patients with completely different symptoms meriting the same diagnosis, that a disorder such as this cannot be caused by a specific gene, and that it's very unlikely that we're going to find a magic bullet that's going to solve this disorder.